Good evening. I'm coming back from LA now. I just came back. I was there from Thursday. We had a very good trip there. All lectures, lots of people came. It was amazing. Next Monday and the following Monday, I won't be here. I'm going to Europe this Thursday and then to Israel. So next two Mondays, no lecture. Always pay attention on my website, divineinformation.com, check on events. It shows you always the updates, the places of the lectures, the address, and the time, and if there's any cancellation. We finish Sefer Bereshit. We started now Sefer Shmot. We have to understand that the Sefer Bereshit is describing 2,200 years of history. From now on, all the rest of the books is only much, much, much less. Because if you really think about it, from Adam until the end of Sefer Dvarim, which means the life of Moshe Rabbeinu, you're talking approximately about 2,400 years. That's it. That's the length of the Torah from the creation of the world. And then Moshe Rabbeinu was about 3,300 years ago, 5,777. So we talk about 2,400 years approximately, which 2,200 of them is in Sefer Bereshit, which means about 200 and something is all the other. For instance, Dvarim is only 1 month. And Vayikra, it's only 1 month also. So it's very interesting. We can see how the Torah, in the beginning, you know, describe how the world started and who gave birth to who and the fathers. It's also called the Sefer Avot, the book of the fathers, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, that's it. From now on, we move on with the story. The parasha begins, Yaakov Avinu, he went to Mitzrayim. He's describing now again, repeating, that they went to Mitzrayim with 70 people. All together, 70 people. And if there are a few more things in this parasha, we have to understand. If we have a chumash here, maybe, if you can get me a chumash. Yeah, there are a few things we have to understand in this parasha. Well, thank you. When we read it, we're not always paying attention to the right details. You'll understand in a minute what I'm talking about. Sometimes you can learn it all your life, but in reality, you never really understood what it's talking about. Here. Vayakom melech hadash, a new king, al Mitzrayim, asher lo yada et Yosef. There's a new king came, you know, like in the election, new president, different strategy. The previous president was nice to Israel, a new president came, doesn't recognize Israel, doesn't care. Right? There's Bush, now Obama came, everything changed. Vayakom melech hadash. Chazal arguing if it was really a new king or it's the same king after he had leprosy, tzarat. Someone who has leprosy is like dead. And then he came back, he was cured. Is he considered that it's the same one or it's really a new king? It's not clear. One way or the other, he pretends either he doesn't really know Yosef or he pretends he doesn't know Yosef. One way or the other, he ignores him. All the appreciation and the gratefulness that they owe Yosef for saving Egypt and all their economy and giving Pharaoh the advice that actually saved them and made them a very wealthy country. In less than a second, they forgot the Jew that saved everything for them right away. Everything like never happened before. Now, they have a committee, the government of Egypt, Pharaoh and his advisors. They say, look, we have a problem. What's the problem? הנה עם בני ישראל רב ועצום ממנו. Look how many Jews in this country. Too many. Everywhere you go, you see them. What's going on here? הבה נתחכמה לו. We have to make a plan. Look how it's the same thing today. Everything is the same. Just, you know, different generation, but the same idea. Tomorrow there's going to be a war with our enemies. They will join our enemy. They can make a revolution here. They take over the control. They cooperate with their enemy. They'll help them to defeat us. And in return, the enemies will put them in charge here. They make an ally, and we're going to be slaves. So what do we have to do? Before they're going to join our enemies, we have to make sure that they're not going to get any power. And they started to think what to do. What's the difference between the Egyptians to the Israelis today? Do you think what they did was smart or foolish? What do you think? Politically. You have a country, like you look what's going on in Europe. France. They started to let the Arabs come in. Another one, and another Mustafa, and another Muhammad, and another Abdullah, and another Ahmed. Now it's millions of them. Who really now control France? The Arabs, that's it. The French are finished. Another 20, 30 years, France will change the flag. The Arabs will force them to put Islam over there. All French people would run away. There's no biggest nightmare than French to lose their country. They're very patriotic, very proud about their culture. But there's something even worse for them, that they will have to escape to the United States, which they hate just as much as they hate the Arabs. You know? So that's going to be a double tragedy for the French people. One is that they lose the country, which they already lost. It's just a matter of time officially how it's going to be. And second thing is where they're going to run to. To run to an Arab country, what's the point? They can stay in France and be under the control of the Arabs. If the French people were smart, they will wake up 30 years ago. And they would limit the laws of immigration. Same thing Germany. They let now a lot of Turkish come in. The Turks filling up Germany. The German people, which they have Nazi blood in them, they're going crazy now. In France, it used to be Sarkozy. It was a clever president. Some say he's a Jew even. A clever president that tried to fight against the problem. Now the new one is very liberal. Liberal are the biggest fools that you can think of. They try to be humane on the expense of destroying themselves. The Torah says you have to be humane. You have to have mercy on people. You have to respect people, but not on the expense of losing your life. That's what these liberals don't understand. I have no problem. Respect strangers. Treat them nice. Everything fine. But not that they're going to come and drink my blood with a straw and throw me to the ocean and take away what we build here and what my fathers built. The problem in Israel, that we have half of the country, these liberals, not only they're not sitting to think how to stop the Hamas and all the murderers that's sitting among us, they're always busy how to help them. With the law, with the court, Supreme Court every week cancel the fence. We made a wall around Israel to protect us from all the murderers. The Israeli court, instead of helping us to protect ourselves from all these murderers, every week they rule to knock down the wall, that they can come in, that they can kill us easier. You understand what's going on? Everything basically over there is democracy, freedom of speech, everyone has equal rights. The people that own the land and the guests that came to the land that declaring that they want to kill the owners of the land, according to those fools, should have the same rights. You understand? Imagine now in California, I heard there's 40% Mexicans. Imagine the Mexicans will start to declare that they want to occupy City Hall in California. They want to take over California and make it their control. Americans, you want to live here? Fine. Mexicans, at least, they don't have plans to murder all Americans. The worst thing can happen, that they would like to take over and put some tacos everywhere. But they have no intention to murder the Americans, at least not that I know of. But the Arabs declare every morning, every afternoon, every evening, from many, many years, that they're waiting for the opportunity to slaughter all Jews. So why do you care about democracy and freedom of speech and equal rights? You must change these foolish laws. You see, these Egyptians here, 3,500 years ago, they were not stupid. They are very clever. They already saw, I'm talking from the side that the laws were against us. But we have to be honest. The Egyptians, when they saw the Jews are spreading in Egypt, they started to realize, if we wait another generation, we will lose our country. They had all the rights to think so. But there's only one problem. What's the difference? Only one problem. The problem is that the Arabs that sits in Israel, or the Mexicans that sits in America, or the Arabs that sits in Europe, they did not contribute anything to the country. They don't help in the country. They only want to destroy the country. Maybe not the Mexicans, but the Arabs. They want to destroy the country. The Jews did not want to destroy Egypt, and Egypt got saved thanks to the Jew. Without Yosef, Egypt would be complete bankrupt. It would be a disaster for them. All their wealth came from this nation. The blessing that Pharaoh got from Yaakov when he arrived. So what really happened? This is what happened. What happened is the Jews started to move from Goshen when they were in a ghetto. They started to move all over Egypt. As long as they did not see them, they all live in one place. Nobody knows who they are. There's no internet, no television to brainwash the Egyptians. No newspaper, no radio. Not one Egyptian saw one Jew all his life. He heard a rumor that there's a group of Jews living in the city of Goshen. Who cares? It's not here. It's not in Manhattan. It's not in the center. It's far away in a suburb. Nobody even goes there. There's no transportation, no trains, no cars. Big deal. What do I care? As long as they're not here, in Wall Street, inside, controlling everything. They can be there forever. I can care less. Worst comes to worst. Tomorrow they'll be too big. We'll make a border. The problem is, when the Arabs are out of Israel, no problem. Let them do whatever they want. Who cares? They want to hate us, they hate us. They want to declare that they kill us, let them declare until tomorrow. And as long as we have a border between us and them. But when they come to live among you and they live in the same building like you, then it's just a matter of time until there will be a war and they will kill you from inside. What do you think? What do you think is going to happen if there's going to be a war and Arab countries will attack Israel and Israel will show signs of surrendering? As soon as the Israeli Arabs will realize that the outside Palestinians and Syrians and Egypt and Jordan are winning the war, 1.5 million Israeli Arab citizens will burn Israel alive. They'll go on the street and make riots to show the new owner that coming to occupy the land, they want to show them that they're faithful, that they're not really Israelis. They live here. They live in Jaffa. They live in Haifa. They live everywhere. We live here. But we're not really Israelis. We are like you. They're going to try to prove to them that they're with them. Otherwise, what? They're going to fight with Israel against the other Palestinians, their brothers? Only a fool has this illusion. And then what happened? The Jews started to move in and actually brought it to themselves. When they started to see them everywhere, they got nervous. They said, whoa, they're occupying every territory here. So they decided, let's start take actions against them. They didn't care about democracy. They were, look, every country have laws. We'll see soon what kind of laws they had in Egypt. But they didn't care about democracy. So we are the owners, you are the visitors. You're not going to have the same rights like us. This is such a stupid law. Imagine you have a house and a guest comes from overseas to stay by your house for a month, and because he's your guest, you're giving him free rights on your house. So now there are two owners to the house, you and him, and he said to you, please don't talk when I'm on the phone. Your guest telling you. You're annoying me. Hey, you're a guest here. I'm very sorry. There's no such thing guest. Equal rights. Equal rights. Tomorrow I kick you out of your home. Very nice. Equal rights. This applies to all countries. Nothing to do with racism or, again, it's Arabs is just an example. It can be between different countries, Turks and Germans. It can be everywhere, so regardless. When a new nation starting to move to another country, if this country won't take actions against it in the beginning, it's just a matter of time they'll be gone. The biggest mistake of the Israelis were after they won the Six-Day War, all of these Arabs ran away. Like rats, they ran away. And Moshe Dayan asked them, please come back. Come back to your homes. Why are you running away? We're not going to hurt you. We want you to come back. And they came back. Because they knew by Egypt, they raped all of them when they controlled them. Or by Egypt. So they were afraid that the Israelis will do the same to them. They didn't expect them to be so nice to them. Come back to your homes. We're not going to touch you. No extra taxes, you're not going to be our slaves, we're going to give you Israeli IDs, you're going to live with us. One day you can be the prime minister. You'll be judges, you'll be doctors, you'll be teachers, you'll sit in our government. We will help you to destroy us from inside. Come, dear Arabs. Come, why are you running away? Come, we're very nice. We're the smartest nation in history, the Jews, or the dumbest. Depend who you ask. I don't think that any Arab country will run to the Jews after they kick them from Libya. Come. All of you from Tripoli, all the Jews, you escaped to Italy, to Rome. Come back. We'll give you back all your millions of dollars in the real estate. Come. Gaddafi wants you back. Come. Take your land. Or Khomeini to all the Persian Jews. Why you move to Great Neck? It's boring over there. Come back to Iran. Come take your land. Come to the government. Sit next to Ahmadinejad. You help us how to protect Iran. Nobody is dumb like us. That's really the truth. I hate to admit it, but the reality is reality. What can I do? So the Jews moved in. The problems began. If they stay in Goshen, maybe until now we'll be in Goshen. Think about it. If the Jews will only stay in Goshen, eventually they'll become a nation. They'll separate from Egypt. Maybe the dream of moving to Israel will never come through. There will not be slavery. There will not be Etziat Mitzrayim. Maybe we'll get the Torah in Goshen. Don't get too excited. We had to come to the Holy Land. That was a part of the plan. It would change the whole movie. Okay. Now comes the next decree. First, taxes. High taxes. It's not worth it to work. Imagine you work and you pay 80% tax. You work, you make $1 million a year. 800,000 go to taxes. It's like a death sentence here. What am I killing myself for? So it says, they started to make them work in camps. They build Are miskenot lefaro et pitom ve'et Ramses. We believe that what the Torah describes here, that the Jews build the pyramids and all these things that you see in Egypt, even though the Egyptians, the Arabs, they hate to admit it. They always try to deny it. But from what it's described here in the Torah, the Bnei Israel are the ones who build all of that. The more they torture the nation of Israel, the more they expand and grow. There's something in life that there is a concept that HaKadosh Baruch Hu always run to help someone that is under stress and someone is chasing him and he has nobody left, then Hashem comes to help him. Elokim yevakesh tanirdaf. Hashem automatically always see that when everyone goes to hunt one person, he gives him extra help, even if he doesn't deserve it. Why? Once he has nobody on his side, Hashem helps him. Elokim yevakesh tanirdaf. So the Jews are working. Remember, before the decrees, they live in Goshen. Yaakov was there. Yaakov passed away. Yosef passed away. Now, the Parnasa wasn't so great because as Yosef was Sar Haotzar, he gave him Social Security. Section 8, all Goshen was Section 8. You know, Social Security. Now, what happened? Your leader, the Jew, is not in the Senate anymore. He passed away. That's it. Who's going to give you Section 8 and forget about it? Right? So what's going on? Over there was no election. It's a dictatorship, Pharaoh. If there was election, like in America, so they want the Jews to vote for them. So they throw them a bone. Don't forget me when the time comes for the election. That's why all the candidates in New York and in America always come to Monsi, to the Hasidim. Why the candidate to be the president of the United States care to meet the Rebbe? Why? You know, the Rebbe is worth for me already 30,000 people in 15 minutes meeting. Why not? Right? Because by the Hasidim, the Rebbe say everyone vote for Obi, everyone votes for Obi, everyone vote for Hillary, everyone vote for Hillary. Finished. That's it. The Rebbe decides. So it's worth it for them. You vote for us, we'll change the zoning. It's not going to be one family. It can be three, four family. You can build 15 homes, one on top of the other. We don't care. As long as we get elected. That's the corruption in elections. So the next decree now, they're starting to see that the Jews giving a lot of births. Technically, think about it. Who can give birth when he's in Auschwitz working from morning to night 16 hours a day? Imagine a woman now in Auschwitz. They're torturing her all day. She has no rest, no food, one slice of bread a day. Does she have the mind now to be with her husband, to have children, to be pregnant? That's the time now to be pregnant in such condition. But it's something very interesting. The Jews are working like a slave, but they give a lot of birth. Shisha bekeres echad. So the Egyptians going crazy. So what did we do by here? We made them slave, fine, but they still continue to grow. One day they'll make a revolution. They rebel. What do you think? It cannot be 20 million people ruling 80 million slaves. The slaves one day will say, wait a minute, we are the majority here. We're not working. What are you going to do? That's the end of it. It's going to be a war. Millions will die, and that will be the end of it. So now they're thinking, how are we going to stop their growth? It's exactly like in Europe with the Arabs. The French has one kid and three dogs, and Abdallah has 8 kids minimum. That's why it's 50 million Arabs in Europe in one generation. Next generation will be 200 million with the kind of growth. And the Europeans are going lower because with one kid, you're actually shrinking. You need 2.6 or 2.8 to stay the same. So the Europeans are shrinking. They don't want to have kids. Why the Europeans don't want to have kids? Because they don't have faith in Hashem. They worry, a kid costs a lot of money to raise. They're thinking how much it's going to cost. They're thinking how much it's cost, and the Arabs now worry. Why? The rotten democracy pay for the kids. Every kid that is born, French give them money. Look what's going on. Apparently the Israeli are not the only fools here. Many Abdallahs are born and they give them money. They're taking over the country. They're blocking the streets. They're doing all kinds of things. And what's the laws over there? No problem. This is what's going on here. The next decree, Pharaoh is calling Shifra and Pua. The midwives. When you give birth to the Hebrew kids, when you see them on a special stone where they give birth, if it's a boy, kill it. If it's a girl, let it live. So right away we see that the number, the quantity, wasn't their concern. Why they want to kill the boy? Should have been the other way around. Who is better slaves, boys or girls? Who works better in construction, in building? Women or men? Usually I don't remember seeing one woman working in construction ever. In a union, I always see them eating donuts, all the workers, and drinking, you know, coffee. Usually I don't see girls there. Maybe the one who moved the traffic with the cones. But the ones who actually drill and this, it's all men. That's the way it is. All the construction sites in Israel, Arab men. You don't have Fatmas and Saida working over there. It's usually all the men. So what's going on here? Why they want to kill the men? You should kill the women, if any. So worry about the quantity. Women, the women give birth. Without women, there will not be growth. The men eventually will die and they will disappear, this nation. So what's the problem? Doesn't make sense what's going on here. Now you see how confused we're going to get in a minute. So Paro said to them, if you see it's a boy, kill it. If it's a girl, let it live. Shifra and Pua, imagine now something like this happened to you, midwife, the president or the king, I want you to kill the baby. What's the first thing you'll do? What's the first thing you'll do? You can't fight with the king. It's a king. You resign. Hey, listen, your majesty, I can't really deliver babies anymore. I wanted to quit anyway. And if he said to you, you can't quit, what would you do? In the middle of the night, escape from the border to a different country. What normal midwife would want to stay and kill babies from morning to night? Every normal human being would try not to murder babies, no? Unless if he himself is a monster, okay, no. Here it's two righteous women. So they didn't listen to Paro. First, why they didn't resign? They should have resigned and said, okay, we quit. Why? Because they knew if they resign, they'll bring different midwives and they'll listen to him. So we must stick to the job because we are the only one who can save the life of these babies. We'll risk our life, but we'll save them. So when Paro found out that they are not killing the boys, he called them into his place. And this is what he said to them. Vayikra melech Mitzrayim lamyaldot. He called them. Vayomer lahem, and he said to them, Madu asiten et hadavar hazeh v'tchayena at hayiladim. Why did you do such thing and revive the kids? The answer that they gave him, the Jewish women are not like the goyot. Before we even arrive, they already gave birth. Like animals, 1, 2, 3. No delay, no contraction, tak, tak, tak. It starts, a minute later they give birth. So when we came, it was already born. So what needs to be done? You just have to cut the cord, hit the baby a little bit on his back, make him scream, and finish. So Pharaoh should have said to them, because you didn't listen to me, we will hang you in the middle of town. That everyone knows when I give an order, you have to listen. But Pharaoh, it seems from here, Pharaoh left them alone. Didn't kill them, they stay alive. But something very interesting, what answer they gave him? Oh, I don't understand, what does he ask, what answer they gave him? It's no connection, Bechla. He say, kill all the boys. What do I care if the boy is born now or he was born 10 minutes earlier? What's the difference? So Pharaoh should have said to them, what do I care if he was already out? Kill him when you get there. From here, what do we see? This is the first argument in the world that is documented in a book about abortion. Everywhere in the world, you have this fight. In countries, in some countries, it's illegal. in some countries is legal, but the religious people are against it. They constantly demonstrate. In Israel, they made 2 million abortions from the time they became a state until now. We should have been another 50 million Jews living in Israel. Instead of 6, it should have been another 50 million. Everyone worry, Arabs, terrorism. How many Jews the Arabs killed since Israel became a state in a war? 24,000 soldiers. How many Jews they kill in terrorist attack? Few more hundreds. 10 here, 3 there, 5 there, 1 here, 2 there, 10 there. Few more hundred. Even you say 5,000 more. All together 30,000 Jews. From the time Israel became a state until now, with all the noise and the screaming, terrorists, murderers, traitors, shame on you, 30,000. And what did the Jews kill? 2 million. Do you see what a hypocrisy this world has? It's scary, scary what's going on over here. So why the Jews kill the babies? Not for terrorism. For what? It's not convenient. She didn't plan to have a kid. She's a young girl. She goes to make sins. Now she got caught by surprise, or he. And that's what's going on. How about giving it to the 15% of the Jews in the world that cannot have children? At least they adopt them. There's a lot of Jews who go to Brazil to buy babies from Brazil. So they buy Brazilian babies, and they go through a big nightmare and lots of money and all until they arrange the legal documents. They'll be able to adopt a goy baby from Brazil. Why not, instead of murdering those Jews, give them for adoption? Give them to this couple, everyone will be happy. They'll get a baby free of charge, and those babies will not be murdered. So, here is the deal. Pharaoh said to them, when the head comes out, the body is still connected inside. Most of the body is inside. So therefore, when he brings the head out, you already know if it's a boy or a girl. If the head came out and it's a boy, don't let the rest of the body come out. Kill him right there and then take the body. If it's a girl, pull her out, no problem. They answered to him, by the time we got there, all the body was out. It's against the law to murder them. Change the law. Change the law in Egypt, in the Congress, no problem. But it's against the law. You're giving us permission when the baby is already outside completely to kill him because Pharaoh didn't know what the Torah said. The Torah said, as long as the baby is inside completely, he's still living thanks to his mother. He doesn't have life on his own. His own life comes from the mother. So if you jeopardize the life of the mother and you have to kill one of them to save the other, you don't kill the mother. You kill him to save the life of the mother. Why? She gives him life. You don't kill her and give him life. And dochim nefesh mipnei nefesh, when the baby comes out already. When he already came, he has his own life. And even if he risks her, but you don't, there's a problem here right now. When he has his own life, you cannot kill him. As long as he's inside, it's like an organ from her body. So if you have to remove a kidney to save the life of a person, you remove the kidney. It's still, you save the person. The baby is still there. You save the mother and not the baby. Once the baby came out, it's too individual. If I have to save Reuven by killing Shimon, I'm not allowed. Once the baby took his head out, not the whole body, the head is everything. In a human being, remember, the head, that's where the human being is, because the soul is in the head. The body is just technical. The head is who you are. The head is your identity, the head is your traits, the head is your soul, the head is your everything divine about you. And when a person dies, if they chop his head off and the body fall here and the head fell down the cliff, you go where the head is and that's where you have to bury him. Not where the body, even though the body is 90% and the head is only 10% from the body in size. There's no such thing. We don't go by physics, we go by spirituality. The head is everything. That's what he didn't know, this Pharaoh. Soon as the head came out, Pharaoh said, okay, the majority of the body is still in, so you can still make the abortion. Once the baby came out, you cannot murder him. Cannot murder him. People will rebel against me here. You know how they make the abortions? You have no idea how they do it. It's crazy. The doctor takes a knife, and he goes all the way to the wound, and begins to chop the baby, which is very small, chop him like this, make a soup from him, completely. And then they have vacuum. They vacuum all the pieces, and then somebody has to check that they didn't leave anything. It's crazy. And the biggest shock is that what do you think they do with all the pieces they vacuum? The little hands, I saw pictures, for a week I couldn't eat. Little hands like this, tiny. Legs, head. They put it together like a puzzle to make sure that they did not forget any piece. They put them to see maybe something was left in, because if something would be left in, it can cause infection and problems, and she won't be able to give birth after that. After they collect so many pieces like this, what do you think they do with that? You're never going to believe it. They sell it to who? To China. And they eat it over there. In China. But today I got something even more shocking than this. There is a video running now on WhatsApp. I was sitting on a plane when I got it. I almost vomit on the person next to me. You're not gonna believe what these Chinese people do. It's like people without souls. Do you know what they do? They eat dogs in China. So it shows in a video how they stuff the dogs in boxes, nets, and they press with the head on there that they will fit in because it's too small. So they smash them inside, and when they take them to kill them, they take their skin off when they're still alive, because it's easy to take the skin off. When he dies, it's sticky. It's a lot more work. So they show you in a video, unbelievable. In the beginning of the video, it says shocking pictures. If you have a weak heart, don't continue. It's a warning in a video. It's the most shocking video I've seen in my life. Can't believe it. You see the head of the dog is still alive with his eyelashes after they took away all his skin. I can't believe it. And they eat them. They cook them and they eat them. When they're still alive, they chop them to pieces. They don't even kill them. I always wonder to myself, why the Torah had to make the law of the Gentiles, one of the seven laws, ever minachai? That first you have to kill the animal, then eat it. I was thinking to myself, who will eat an animal when the animal is still moving and alive? I got my answer today. Hashem is always right in the end. Sometimes it takes us time to understand and digest. What's happening in this world, you cannot digest what's going on here. You know, when the Thailandian and the Chinese came to Israel to replace the Arab in constructions in the previous intifada, in 1 year, half of the dogs and cats in Israel disappeared. It took the Israeli few months to realize that the Thailandi eat their dogs. I have a friend, a parachuter. One time he came to my house for Shabbat and he told me that he just came from Thailand. He was telling me what's going on over there. So he said, there was one person I had an argument with a Thailandi, a tourist. Somehow, stupid argument. The Thailandi screamed something. 30 Thailandi came from everywhere. They all coming, running. And they were beating up this tourist with such brutality. He was begging for his life, and they don't stop until he dies. They don't leave him alone. For a little argument. So he said to me, this guy was... Baruch Hashem, today is Shomer Shabbat. Back then, he wasn't even Shomer Shabbat, complete secular. So he said to me, this is the first time I've seen in my life people with no soul, no conscience, no soul, no mercy, no heart. Then I could understand what the Nazis were able to do to the babies and to the people and Mengele and all these things. But I've seen it in my own eyes how they were hitting this guy, and there's no such thing mercy, and they're not even angry at him, because they all came from everywhere. They have nothing to do with him. It's not that someone got you angry and you lost your mind. Later you regret what you did to them. For them it's like fun. To torture him to death. So, now HaKadosh Baruch Hu saw that Shifra and Puas risked their life to save these babies. The Torah says, they were afraid of Hashem. Hashem made them homes. What kind of homes? He built them a house in Forest Hills Garden? What do you mean by Aslan Batim? They already had homes. No. The answer, Bate Levia Uvate Keuna Uvate Levia. Kingdom, it's called Bet Amlucha. Bet Amlucha, like the house of the king. We know that everything HaKadosh Baruch Hu does is measure for measure, for good and for bad. When someone gets a reward, is measure for measure. When someone gets punished, also measure for measure. Please explain to me what's measure for measure here. They risk their life to save babies. Hashem build them homes. What's the connection between Batei Keuna? Hashem say the Kohanim and the Leviim comes from you. What's the connection? If you want to say that he built them real estate, homes, that's even stranger. It's more strange. Why? Why it's more strange? Because there's really no connection now, no measure for measures. You have to say, okay, you save lives of people. One day your children will be in a jeopardy. I'll save their life. Or I'll give you children. Or something similar. That's measure for measure. The answer, what's the connection between the fact that Hashem made the Kohanim come from them and the Leviim come from them to the fact that they saved the baby? The answer is, Pharaoh, he already knew from Yaakov, Yitzchak, and Abraham, this was the royal family of the world. As Ephron Achiti, when Abraham bought Me'arat HaMachpelah in Hebron, he said to Abraham, you are the president of God among us. You're a very holy person. The whole world knows who you are. What's the big deal between me and you? Take it for free. That's how it started, the negotiation. In the end, he killed him on a price. When my OF Kesef, Lois Ba Kesef. Someone that loved money, even from his own brother, he ripped him on a price. He can't control this desire. If he has to sell to his parents, he'll still charge the money. Why? For him, his money is his God. I know many people like this. When it comes to money, please don't talk to us. Business, business, Rabbi, business. Business. Business, ooh, the Ten Commandments. Business comes before everything. So what's happening here? So they know that this family is special, especially when Yosef, the son of Yaakov, now they saw who he is. He has Ruach HaKodesh. He knows how to interpret dreams. They see what's going on here. So Pharaoh knew that the Jews one day will go out of Egypt and build Beit HaMikdash. That's the tradition of the Jews. They have to come out of Egypt, they have to get the Torah, they'll build Beit HaMikdash. For Beit HaMikdash, what do you need? You need Kohanim and Leviim. If you don't have Kohanim and Leviim, how are you going to have Beit HaMikdash? You must have Kohanim. You have Beit HaMikdash and you don't have any Kohen, there's nothing you can do there. So Pharaoh said, I have an idea. That's why he started to kill the boys. Otherwise, he should have killed the girls. He say, one generation will kill all the boys. The old people, they'll die in the meantime. All these Jewish women will force them to marry Egyptian. When a Jewish woman marry Goyim, the Goy is not a Kohen, right? Maybe Kohen Midian, Itro Kohen Midian. Well, Kohen is not a Kohen.
So now, all the Jewish women that will be left will marry Goyim, will continue to give birth. All these kids will be Jewish. They'll continue to be slaves. And in one generation, I will make sure that they will never have Kohanim left. And therefore, what's going to happen later on? There's no point of taking them out of Mitzrayim. So Hashem said, not only they're going to have Kohanim, the Kohanim will come from Shifra and Pua for risking their life and saving the babies. And Hashem said, the Kohanim will come from you. Then Amram and Yocheved, the parents of Moshe Rabbeinu, they already have two kids, Miriam and Aaron. Now it's time to give birth for Moshe. Vatelet ben, she gave birth. Vatere oto kitov, special. Vatitzpeneu, remember, they're killing the babies. As in China, if you want to give birth to another kid, it's against the law. You have to go out of China or to hide somewhere. Or you have to do it privately. You cannot go to the hospital, they report you. So now, if they find out they gave birth, they're going to take the kid and kill him. She hid him 3 months. Then she couldn't hide him anymore. So she put him in a special teva. She put tar, she made it insulated. And she put him inside and she put him on a Nile. And Miriam was standing over there watching to see what's going to be with him. Batya, the daughter of Paro, she came and she saw Moshe Rabbeinu. She saw him, she had mercy on him. She said, it's a Jew. How did she know he's a Jew? How did she know? Two options. One, he was circumcised. Two, who would hide a baby? Only one that it's against the law for him to have the baby. Egyptians don't have to hide the babies. Which one of the two you think caused her to know he's a Jew? One of the two or both? First, you know Moshe Rabbeinu was born circumcised. Some people in the world, even today, they're born circumcised. They don't have Orla. So what do? The Mohel just take one little drop, very little pinch, one tiny drop of blood comes. That's called Atafa Dambrit. That's the same thing what we do to the non-Jewish candidate when they come to convert. Most of them, almost all of them, are circumcised in a hospital. Because it's very common here in America to circumcise by a doctor, which some of these doctors are Jewish mo'alim also, by the way. That they also do Brit Milah, conservative, reform, Hashem Irachem. So they do it for money, very good business. They circumcise Tony and Vinny and Chris. And what happened, when this Chris come to convert, there's nothing to cut. So, you know this little device that the Tibetic people take a drop of blood to check if they have sugar or not? Same thing they use. They make one tiny drop, no feeling, no nothing. One blood comes out, that's called Atafa Dambrit. When they convert, they go into the mikveh, finished. So she took Moshe. Hashem directed that the savior of the nation of Israel will grow where? Where? In the house of Pharaoh. Pharaoh will feed and pay the bills of the one who's going to defeat him. Same thing, Haman prepared the tree for himself. He thought it's for Mordechai. He prepared it for himself. History shows all the time when the wicked one comes to attack the righteous, all the plans that he did against him, usually in the end turns against him. There's many psukim like this in Tehillim. Tov, Moshe, when Moshe is a prince, he walks and he sees brothers and sisters working slaves in the camps. So he went and started to help them. He started to help, like he said to Pharaoh, I'm going to be in charge of the work. So he helps as much as he can. Moshe is coming to help. Moshe did not send money. Sometimes when you say, hey, American Jews, There are Jews who are dying in Europe. So they say, okay, how much we have to write a check? We have to build Bet HaMikdash. Okay, how much the donation has to be? No, we don't want your money. We want you to come help. Do something physically. Moshe went to help. The next thing you see, Egyptian hit a Jew. He kills him. Later it was found out, the liberal Jews, Datan and Aviram, they said to him, you want to kill us like you kill him? Moshe said, oh, Jews already speaking Lashon Hara. Now I understand why they have to suffer so much. Hashem doesn't do anything for nothing. That's what Chazal said. And Moshe felt, until now he didn't understand why the Jews are getting punished. But after, he said, look, he wants to turn against me to run tell Pharaoh that I killed the Egyptian that was killing a Jew. Instead of telling me, great, for protecting your brother from getting killed, the liberal Jew wants to run to Ahmed. Come, I'll tell you where the Israeli soldier who killed your brother, the terrorist, is, that you can go and kill him. That's what they do in Israel today. Moshe saw that he's dealing with Smolanim, and he said, you know what? I better run out of here before it'll be too late. He ran to Midian. He comes to Midian. The Midrash Rabbah and also Midrash Tanchuma, this is what it says. Three found their soulmate in the well. How do you say well in Hebrew? Be'er. Be'er. How do you say bar in Hebrew? Same letters. Bet Aleph Resh. Our fathers found their wives in a well. We find our wives in a bar. Same letters, different meaning. That's why their marriage was so blessed, and what's going on today in the world is not exactly blessed. So the Midrash say, who are the three who found their wives in a well? Without shatchaniot. They didn't have to pay fee. Who? Yitzchak. Yaakov and Moshe. It says like this. What was special, what's very similar between Rachel and Tzipora? Rachel and Tzipora both met their husband in a well. What's special about both of them? Both of them call after an animal. Tzipora and Rachel, it's names of animals. Each one of them gave birth to two boys. And their husband worked for their father-in-law after they got married. He got them in the business to be the shepherd of the sheep. Both of them were shepherds themselves before they got married. That's why they went to the well, to give water to the sheep. Both of them had to marry a husband that had to escape from the country where they're born. They had to run away. A lot of similarity. Now the shepherds come. Over there in Midian, there was no such law, ladies first. They kick them out. Here comes the savior. Rabbi Avraham Seba. He was one of the Jews who were evicted from Spain. He wrote, there are three times that Moshe Rabbeinu risked his life to save a miserable person from his attacker. Three times. Where? One, he saved the Jew from the Egyptian. That's why he had to escape from Egypt. Then when the two Jews were fighting with each other, Datan and Aviram, he came to break it up before someone will kill the other. And that's when they told him, oh, you want to kill me like you killed the Egyptian? And he had to escape from Egypt. And the third time right here, when he had to go to a fight with the shepherds, not to kick the Tzipora and the other females there. Three times Moshe risked his life. What does the Torah trying to teach us by showing us that Moshe is a very brave man who fight for the miserable person to protect him always? And why you have to give us three examples? It's enough, you give us one or two. Why you need to give us three examples? What's the difference between the three cases? Each case has something unique about it. First case, second case, and third case. First case was a goy attack a Jew. Second case, a Jew attack a Jew. Third case, goy attack a goy. Why the Torah had to show three different cases? If a goy attack a Jew, needless to say, "Lo ta'amod al dam recha," you have to save your brother from the enemy. Okay. Next case, one Jew attack a Jew. Who told you you're allowed to help one and not the other? Who told you his blood is more red than the other? Maybe you should not push your nose. The Torah wants to teach you, it doesn't matter. One rodef after the other, you give him a warning, it doesn't stop, you attack him. You stop his chasing after the other person. And what's the third case? What is it his business? Goyim attack a goya. Why should he push his nose, risk his life? Huh? Ahmed attack Fatma. So Moshe wants to risk his life to save Fatma from Ahmed? Why? What's the Torah is trying to say here? First two make sense, no? Third case, if there's no life risk, why not to help her? After all, she needs someone to save her from this monster. But saving her, you can risk your life. Are you going to die for her? What does she have to do with you? The Torah wanted to show you that Moshe Rabbeinu didn't have politics. When he saw someone is under attack, he always ran to help him, whether he's a Jew, whether he's a goy, whether he's anyone. He runs to help the weak against the strong one who takes advantage on him. This is the traits of a true leader. True leader always look how to save and help the weak and the miserable people. Not like today. All presidents here only do everything they can to help the billionaires. Warren Buffett came on the news a few years ago. He said, "What's going on in this country? I'm paying less taxes than my receptionist." You remember this or no? Mm-hmm. Why? Do you know why? Why someone who makes billions of dollars every year pay percentage-wise less than the poor receptionist who probably make $1,000 a week? Where is the logic here? Same thing in Israel, by the way. Why? Because who put the president in power? These billionaires, tycoons. What do you think? They give donation for nothing? Only when it comes to Torah, there are people who give donation for the sake of heaven, not for their stomach, not for kavod. How do you know? Some of them give anonymous donation. No one would know how to say thank you to them. They refuse to publish their name. Anonymously, they send the money. And you know they're only doing it for one reason, between me and Hashem, nothing else. I won't get anything from it. Person that I gave him won't know it's me. Nobody else would know how to bow down to me because he doesn't know I gave it. That's really pure donation, not for personal gain. But the politicians, when they receive donation, when there was never one donation in history that was not conditional. I'm helping you now. When you be in power, you cut this tax, you change this law, you open here, you make peace with Cuba, there's oil over there. That's the way it is. I'll tell you a story. Many years ago, When I was giving a lot of lectures in Great Neck back then, two or three times a week it was, I met a very nice family. It's called Aryeh family. Aryeh family. Apparently, the story of this family is very interesting. The grandfather of this family, when the Shah was in France, first Shah was in France, he wanted him to come to the country, to back to Iran, to take control. So Baruch Hashem, he was very wealthy back there in Iran. So the story that I heard, he gave the Shah an open check. He said, write any amount you need for you to come and take this country. And the Shah came, and he took over. And later, one day the Shah said to him, go buy all the properties over there. Places, no sewer, no electric, no nothing. Go buy. Buy all this area. Buy. We're going to announce that we make roads, sidewalks, electric, sewer. The value of this property will go 10 times more or 20 times more. And he paid him back not only what he gave him, with lots of profit. The difference here, that he gave him the check and he took a huge risk. He could still fail and not come and lose. And the money will go to the garbage. Plus, he never told him, when you be the king, you pay me back. It worked out that Shah Goy was a grateful person. He said, this Jew put me back in power. I have to pay him back. I'm not going to take advantage. And he paid him back. And even if the details of the story is not 100%, because you know how it is, stories after tens of years, you don't know all the details. But the concept of the story, that's usually how it works. What the receptionist going to give the president? She's going to put him into power? The pharmaceutical and the gun companies, they are the ones who give all the money. If they want to make you a president, if they really, really want, even if it will cost them $1 billion, they'll do it. They'll advertise, they brainwash the people, commercial every 20 seconds in every channel. Yes, it's all about money. They take a movie star puppet that doesn't know how to write his name and make him the president of the United States. Why, in a movie, he has a nice blorit and a nice cigar sitting on a horse. By the way, that president was the best one ever. The movie star was better than all the others. So Moshe couldn't see something, a disgrace, and ignore it. Now, why Hashem needed to choose a leader that is stuttering? Shepherd, stuttering. Couldn't find somebody more worthy for the job? Someone with nice blorit, nice $10,000 suit, no? With the power of speech. Yes, we can! Somebody charismatic, sleeky, tongue, you know? Why take someone? Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you. People are going to say, what's going on here? Why? Hashem does something for nothing? Who knows why Hashem did this? If Moshe Rabbeinu had the power of speech, smooth, clean, neat, sharp tongue, no one would ever believe 100% in Hashem and the Torah. One or two generations later, people would say Moshe was a great demagogue. How he fooled everyone. Great manipulator. Sharp tongue. Charismatic. Influence. How he fooled millions. Like Hitler, Yimach Shimo. All the screaming and all the crazy people. He destroyed them in a mind. Even those who didn't plan to kill the Jews all of a sudden became obsessed with that, the way he did it. If Moshe would be this kind of speaker, influence the thousands and millions, we will have a big doubt. But when Moshe himself, you could see that that wasn't his style. And everyone accepted the Torah one way or the other, it leaves no doubt. One more thing. What was the special hard job that the Egyptians did to the nation of Israel? They let the women do the men's job, and they let the men do women's job. So they destroyed them mentally. Mentally. Which means, imagine a man has to do kneading. This big macho, masters like this. And a woman, tiny, you know, 100 pound, bricks. Plus, she's pregnant and have 6 inside her stomach, and she has to pick up the bricks. Ay, 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 ay. Amarish Lakish. Rish Lakish. In the Gemara, Amagbi Ayad al Chavero. Someone who raised his hand to hit his friend. Nikra Rasha. Already, you can call him wicked. Why? He didn't hit him. Sometimes you say to someone, get out of here before I smack you. And he runs away. He didn't hit him. You never had intention to hit him. It was just a threat. So you're wicked already? How do we learn it? I would think, when you smack, you're wicked. When you're not, when you didn't smack, you held yourself. Many things we want to do and then last minute we stop. It doesn't make us wicked. The opposite, we get a credit for overcoming our drive and desire. Over here, as soon as you picked up your head, Nikra Rasha. Why? How does Rish Lakish know? The answer, when Moshe came to Datan and Aviram, they're hitting each other. Vayomer l'arasha lama taker e'echa. They didn't hit him yet. Just picked up his head to hit him. He said to, the Torah already called him Rasha. Moshe said to the wicked one, why will you hit? Not why you hit. Why will you hit? Why are you going to hit your friend? Lama take. Automatically is already considered Rasha. Someone who runs away from control doesn't want to be a politician, doesn't want to be the chief rabbi of the shul, doesn't want to be the president of the board. Please, you deserve to be. Come, take over. No, leave me alone. I'm not interested. I don't want to control anyone. Don't want this show off. Thank you very much. Someone like that, the control run after him. But someone that run after control only gain people to hate him more and rebel against him and fight him and make his life a nightmare. You can see that in politics. People who wants to get the job, in the end, even if they get there, they don't have one day of rest. But people who are not interested, I don't want to be. I'm not interested. No, please, you have to. No, I don't want. No, please, we're begging you. Take the job. Do you think Moshe Rabbeinu had 100% faith? Do you think anyone in the history had 100% faith? Do you know what it means, 100% faith in Hashem? That Hashem puts you on his hand, on the Empire State Building, and he said, jump. Jump. And you jump with no fear. You don't even have 1 second of fear in your heart. If you had 1 second of fear before you jump, that means your faith is now 100%. Do you think there was someone that you take him and put him on the Empire State Building? He knows Hashem won't let him die in the back of his mind. But when Hashem said to him, jump, trust me, jump, If you have a butterfly in your heart, oh, yo, to jump, oh, mamma mia. You know, that's already 99%, 98%, 95% faith. Some people will not jump. Hashem, I'm sorry. I'm not jumping. How do I know that Moshe didn't have 100% faith? Who am I to say such a thing? The Rambam writes about Avraham Avinu, that he says Sarah is his sister. He gives few examples of the greatest people in history that they still have a little tiny issue with the faith. Because faith is very, very hard mitzvah. When Hashem said to Moshe, throw the cane, it will become a snake. And Moshe threw the cane, and it became a cobra. What happened to Moshe? He went like this. Whoa. He ran away from the snake. You're afraid of a snake when you Hashem is sending you as a messenger? Hashem just told you, throw the stick, it will turn into snake. As soon as you throw him, it turned into snake. You should have stand over there and smile. Ma. Well, I mean, Hashem is sending me. I'm a messenger now. What can happen to me? Ma, it will be the biggest embarrassment that I'm going to make the stick into a snake and he beat me in front of Paro. What the bouchot. So even though you know in your mind that nothing can happen to you, instinct, reaction, he ran back. ואחר כך באו משה ואהרון ויאמרו אל פרעה. משה and Aaron, they came and they say to Paro, they say, where are the 70 skenim? Where are the skenim? There was a government. The answer, אמרו רבותינו, הלכו עמהם הזקנים והיו מגנבים. On the way to Pharaoh, Moshe walked, Aaron and all the older people, the leaders of the nation, followed them. Slowly, slowly, every few seconds, another one of them make a turn and run away. Why? Why? They're afraid to come in front of Pharaoh and attack him in his own palace. Hashem sent Moshe to tell Pharaoh, send my nation out of Mitzrayim. To come into the house of the king in his face, in front of all his army, and tell him, I'm giving you an ultimatum. You give my nation permission to leave, or you're gonna start messing up with me, and you're gonna have problems. You have to be brave. So the old people, they were afraid. Say, what happened if it's not gonna work out? What's gonna be? Paro will execute us. One by one, they were running away. In the end, by the time they got to Pharaoh, only Moshe and Aaron stayed. All the leaders. Now, these leaders were righteous or wicked? What do you think? Who were these leaders? How Moshe picked them? When Hashem said to Moshe, Esfa lecha 70 skenim, collect to you 70 older leaders. Who did Moshe choose? People that own tobacco companies and oil? On newspapers, judges, lawyers, big doctors, who did Moshe choose? Who were these leaders, do you know? The couples. The Germans, they assigned Jews to be couples. They're in charge of the Jews in a camp, and if there's an issue, we call the Nazi. But the couples, many of them were more cruel than the actual Germans to save their own skin. They wanted to show the Germans that they so faithful in their job, so they were torturing their brothers to save themselves from getting beaten up. These couples, however, when the Egyptian gave them material and say, you be in charge of the job, if the job is not getting done, we're gonna hit you. These ones, they were getting beaten up every day to protect their people. That's why Hashem say, collect them into the Senate, into the government. But even they, when they're righteous, they were beaten up to protect the slaves, their brothers. It's not so simple to get hit by a whip every day because you want to save strangers. Just because they are from your nation. You have to be a serious tzaddik, righteous. But to stand in front of Pharaoh, they were afraid. So they ran away. So what do you think was Hashem's response to that? Did he get angry at them or he let it go? What do you think? אמר להם הקדוש ברוך הוא לזקנים, השם say to them, כך עשיתם? That's what you did. Such an embarrassment. You ran away from the mission. חייכם, I promise you, שאני פורע לכם, I'm going to pay you what you deserve. אמתי, when? בשעה שעלו משה ואהרון עם הזקנים להר סיני לקבל את התורה, when משה and אהרון started to climb on Mount Sinai to receive the Torah, החזירם הקדוש ברוך הוא שנאמר, ואל הזקנים אמר, שבו לנו בזה. The elder people also follow Moshe to accept the Torah. And he said to them, you sit here. Sit here. Everything in life, midah כנגד midah. Measure for measure. Measure for measure. I said before, Moshe protected Tzipora. He didn't know eventually she'd become his wife. Right now, she's a stranger. He's protecting her from these shepherds, the Goyim. Right? When her father heard, he had gratitude. He said, bring the man. Bring him to eat by us. All of a sudden, his whole life changing. He got a job. He got a wife. I'll tell you a story that happened here in New York. True story. You tell me what you think. One Jew fell on the subway track in Manhattan. One big black guy, you know, jumped quick. Everyone was going crazy, screaming because the train is coming. People are afraid to jump down, and how are you going to climb back? Train, it's dangerous. But this gorilla jumped, he's very athlete. He jumped right away, picked up the Jew, picked him up like this, threw him back to the platform, and he jumped, and the train came, and the Jew got saved. Then he went and sat back on a bench like nothing happened. People are crying, excited. He went back to sit. Like nothing happened. The Jew came to him and said to him, do you realize what you just did? You just saved life. Why are you so cold? The guy answered him, listen, man, I have to be at work in 10 minutes. And I have a huge pile of dishes to wash in a restaurant where I work. I'm making $10 an hour. 5 more minutes delay here. If a person will get killed here, it will get stuck the trains all day and I won't go to work and I'm gonna lose $50 and I need the money. That's what he told him. So now the Jew has a big dilemma. When the Jew fell, he was very panicking. It was a matter of few, I don't know, 30 seconds, a minute, that he knew, maybe I won't make it. Maybe I get hit by the train. So he made a vow that the person that will save him will give him a nice gift. Now he's asking if he has to give this black guy the gift when this guy already declared to him, your life worth nothing for me. I only did it to save my $50. I don't want to get stuck here on a train. So the question is, do you think this guy deserved the prize or no?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Huh?
Yeah.
Yes. Why yes?
He made a vow. Saved his life still.
But the person that made the vow, the Jew, had in mind that the person that came to actually save my life. This guy didn't want to save his life. He wanted to save himself.
He would know ahead of time. Either way, whatever the intention was, that he'd be saved, would he still give the gift?
Even if we know that he has no intention to save his life. Yosef HaTzadik gave a gift to the priests of Egypt that saved him from death when he got caught after the Eshet Potiphar complained that she made up a lie story about him. They wanted to kill him. So they say they knew that he's right. They knew that he did nothing with her. So they say to Pharaoh, to Potiphar and to Pharaoh, you can't kill him. Make this silent. I know you're going to have big embarrassment that your wife went with the servant. Put him in jail and that's it. But he doesn't deserve to die. When Yosef became the master of Egypt and all the money was in his hand, he did not take their land to Pharaoh. He let them keep their lands. Everybody else lost their lands. He let them keep their property. Rak admat ha-kohanim lo kana. The Shlach HaKadosh, 500 years ago, in Tzfat, Rav Horvitz, in a book, in Tochechat Musar, he says like this. The question is, in our case, in a case like this, do we even have a gratitude to a person that admits that he had no intention to do you a favor, but to himself? The answer, still obligated. When Moshe came to Midian, he saved not Yitro. They said, Ish Mitzri tzilanu min haroim. An Egyptian man saved us from the shepherd. Right? Vechi Moshe Mitzri haya. Moshe was Egyptian? Was an Egyptian. Ela amar le Moshe, Ish Mitzri tzil etchem. Moshe said to them, what does it mean, Ish Mitzri tzil etchem? Why Moshe didn't say anything? He said, do you know why you got saved? Thanks to the Egyptian man that I had to kill in Egypt. When I saw him killing a Jew, I had to kill him first. Because I killed him, I had to run to here. Because I had to run to here, I saved your life from these shepherds. So who really saved you? Ish Mitzri. If you really think about it. Without the Ish Mitzri, you wouldn't get saved. The Ish Mitzri had any intention to save the daughters of Yitro. He wanted to kill a Jew. Haman. Haman loved the Jews or wanted to kill all the Jews? The Gemara say, Mibnei banav shel Haman lomdim Torah bebnei Brak. The grandchildren of Haman learning Torah in Israel, in Bnei Brak. How can it be? Haman is Amaleki. Haman Agagi. How do you have his children ended up converting to Judaism and learn Torah? How? What's his merit? The answer, because the Jews got so scared to die, all of them unanimously made a serious tshuva, repentance. It was such a great moment in the history that the entire nation, there was 1 hour that everyone was righteous. Full tshuva. No lefties, no liberals, no reform, no conservative, none of this nonsense. Everyone fully devoted, religious, screaming with tears in Shushan, ashes on the head, wearing a sack, reading Tehillim for 3 days, thanks to this monster, Haman, which was the former Hitler. To give Haman a prize for wanting to kill all the children of God, obviously it's not possible. But his children already, thanks to their grandfather, Yimach Shimo, that have all Jews made tshuva, Hashem had to give them some kind of a reward. We see here that even if a person didn't mean, but something good came out of it, something he deserved to get. Scary. Imagine if he meant, if he means to save, or he means for everyone to do tshuva, what's going to be his reward? Before we finish, we have 5 more minutes.
They ask Chatam Sofer, Rav Moshe Sofer in Hungary, the Chatam Sofer 250 years ago. They ask him, a student, why every Chacham in a Jewish nation, we called him Rav. Rav before. But in Moshe Rabbeinu, we say first Moshe, then Rabbeinu. Everywhere, Arav Ovadia, Arav Eliashiv, Arav Shach, Moshe first, then Rabbeinu. You don't find anybody call his rabbi of his shul, Yitzchak Harav, Yosef Harav, Yosef Rabbeinu. No. Rabbeinu Yosef, Harav Yosef. You don't ever Yosef Harav. Why would Moshe Rabbeinu, it's first Moshe, then Rabbeinu? What do you think? The answer, listen to his brilliance. He say, by Moshe, is different than all the other rabbis in history. Why? What made the rabbis important that we give them a title? The Torah. They know Torah. And their knowledge in Torah gave them their title, the rabbi. So what comes first? The Torah that made them important, you put the title of the Torah, rabbi. But Moshe was great before the Torah was given. Was already the leader. So Moshe was great before the Torah was given to him. He was greater after, but he already had the value before the Torah was given to him. Before we finish, what's over there? The party here? Moshe Rabbeinu has a revelation. HaKadosh Baruch Hu speaks to him from the bush. Take your shoes off. That's where the Arab learns to take their shoes when they walk into their mosque. They read in the Torah that Hashem said to Moshe, the place where you're standing is holy, take your shoes off. When the Arabs say, the Jews in Beit HaMikdash took their shoes off. Moshe, the rabbi, took his shoes off. We'll take our shoes off in a mosque. So, Hashem came to Moshe from a bush. Bush, it's not a tree, it's not tall, it's low, humble. Hashem could have come in a huge tree. No, a tiny bush. The bush is burning, but it's still staying full. Now Hashem say to Moshe, I want you to go take the Jewish nation out of Egypt. Moshe say, when they ask me who sent you, what should I say? So Hashem say to him, Eyeh asher eyeh. What we say in English, whatever. What difference does it make? The boss. What does it matter? What's his name? Whatever I'll be, I'll be. No big deal. Wait. So Hashem said to him, I'm the God of your father, Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Vayaster Moshe Panav. Moshe put his face, his hand on his face, ki yare me'abit el ha'elokim. Was afraid to look into the fire of a bush. Hashem said to him, I see the suffering of my nation in Mitzrayim and hear their screams and I feel their pain. I'm coming to save them from the Egyptians and to take them to the land, the good land, wide land, the land of honey and milk. The place where the Kna'anim, Chiti, Emori, Prizi, Chivi, and Yevusi are sitting right now. Here comes the screaming of the nation of Israel to me, and I see the pressure that the Egyptians pressuring them. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to take my nation out of Mitzrayim. And Moshe answered to Hashem, who am I that I would stand in front of Pharaoh? I am going to take the nation of Israel out of Mitzrayim? He was very humbled, Moshe. Hashem said to him, relax. Vayomer ki eye imach. I'll be with you. Veze lecha aot. This is the sign that you can use that I sent you. When you take the nation out of Mitzrayim, they all gather the mountain. Vayomer Moshe la Elohim. When I go there, they ask me, what's his name? Hashem say, Yeye asher eye. Shlachani elechem. Vayomer od Elohim el Moshe. And Hashem say to Moshe, this you say to the Bnei Israel, your God, the God of your father, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, sent me to him, to you. This is my name for eternity. This is my memory for generations. Go and collect the elders of the Israelite nation, and you tell them, your God, the God of your fathers, came to me, and he said that he's going to save us and take us out of Egypt. What happened after that? He said, go to Pharaoh and tell him that you want to come out of Egypt for 3 days to sacrifice to your God. And I know that Pharaoh will not let you go. And that's very good. Why? They will give me a reason to strike on them. If Pharaoh surrender right away, what reason I have to strike? But since he's going to give you our time, it's good, it's very good. Ve'eketi et Mitzrayim, okay. And then it says, ve'sha'ala isha mishchenta, every Jewish woman will borrow from the Egyptian neighbor silver and gold and dresses. You put it on your children, your boys, your girls, and take advantage of Egypt. Take advantage on them. What's the, after all this, if you were Moshe Rabbeinu, would you be happy, or you'd be angry, or you'd be upset, or you'd be skeptic after such a promise? This is what Moshe answered. Moshe said, they're not going to believe me. They will not listen to me. They'll say, we don't believe that God spoke to you. Technically here, Hashem should have been very angry already. He should have said to Moshe, I don't understand. I said to your father, grandfather Abraham, take your son Yitzchak, say, yes, sir. Everything I told them, yes, sir. I told Yaakov, yes, sir. I come to you, you're arguing with me. How long these arguments took place, do you know? Until Moshe agreed to go. How long until Moshe agreed to go on a mission? 1 week. 1 week back and forth. So now here is the point now. Hashem answered to Moshe, what's in your hand? He says, stick. Throw it. Became a snake. Moshe ran away from the snake. Okay, from the stick. Okay, from the snake. Hashem say, hold his tail. He held the tail. He became a stick again. Put your hands under your arm. Snow, like leprosy. Put it back. It's fine. Hashem shows him his strength, his power. Hashem said to him, don't worry. If they won't believe the first sign, they'll believe the second sign. And if they won't believe those two signs, and they won't listen to you, take some water from the Nile, pour them on the floor, they'll become blood all over. So Moshe answered to Hashem, I'm not a man of speeches. I'm not exactly know how to speak. Since my whole life, yesterday and before, I never gave speeches to stand in front of the king and give him a speech. Why? Because I'm stuttering. I have speech problems. There is no United States that pays $70 an hour to speech therapists to help children everywhere. There was no speech therapy back then. So he had speech issues. So Hashem answered him, who gave the mouth to a person? Who make a person mute? Who make a person deaf? Who make the person blind? When I say people are born blind as results of what they did in their previous life, people get angry. It's a verse in the Torah. Hashem says, I'm making people blind. Why? Because I enjoy to torture them. So it says, go and I'll be with you and I'll put words in your mouth. Relax. Now, after all this conversation, Hashem started to get angry at him. Vayichar af Hashem b'Moshe. He said, your brother Aaron, the Levi, ידעתי כי ידבר ידבר הוא. I knew he's going to talk. וגם הנה הוא יוצא לקראת חד. Don't worry. כמו משה said to Hashem, my brother Aaron is 83. And I'm 80. It's not fair you're sending the young brother on a mission. My brother is older, he's a tzaddik. You have to send him. So Hashem said to him, don't worry. I'm telling you, I know what the person think. When Aaron see that you go on a mission, וראהו ושמח בליבו. He'll be very happy. So you have nothing to worry about it. He's a tzaddik. He's not a jealous politician. Why he got it? I'm the oldest here. No. So everything Hashem is trying to say to convince him, still not working out. So he said, Aaron will be your mount, and you'll be the master. Take the stick, because you're going to need it for the magics. After all this, Hashem said to Moshe, after I'll gather you around the mountain and I will speak to you and they hear me speaking to you, they will believe in you for eternity. This is, by the way, in case you didn't realize why I'm reading you the whole part, this is a proof why Christianity and Islam is a big lie. Who got the point? Here, from the Torah that the Muslims and the Christians admit that is the book of God, from here you see that their religion is against the rules. When Moshe said they would not believe me because it's my word against their word, I'm going to come, they say, how do we know God spoke to you? What, were you fools? Every crazy person has dreams and come and claim that God spoke to him. I myself got already hundreds of them over the last 20 years. Today I got a message. Today. God told me to contact you because you're the only one can help me. I got a message like this. You don't believe me? I'll read it to you. I know, it's hard to believe. We're just talking about it, and a few hours ago I got a message. People living in some kind of, I don't know, illusion, dream, hallucination, don't really know what to say. So the question is, no, it's here. I just have to go. There's so many messages until we find it. So the question now we have, Hashem say to him, of course they won't believe in you. What, they crazy? Every person who come and tell a story right away will believe in him. But after I am going to do all these amazing things, and after I'm going to speak to you in a mountain, and everyone hears that I speak to you, after that, they'll believe in you for eternity. Which means, if you only come and say to them that basically the only thing is that Hashem spoke to me in a hidden place by the bush or in a dream like Mary. God came to me in a dream. Or Muhammad, I was alone in a desert and the angel gave me the Quran. All these stories are not reliable. Why? Because they're against the rules. You need at least two loyal witnesses. If there's no witnesses, it's always going to start with 50% doubt. If it starts with 50% doubt, that's not what Hashem wants. Hashem doesn't want 50% doubt. Therefore, we have to understand what's going on here. The Christians and the Muslims build their entire religion on a story of a person or woman or man that made up a story. We know for sure it's a lie, but even they should have known it's a lie. How? Because Hashem already wrote in the Torah, why would I give religion to a nation based on a story with no witnesses? The only way we're going to do it is after they all hear me speaking to you, and right after that, they'll believe in you forever. Now, I want to ask you a question. When Moshe came to Pharaoh and he threw the stick on the floor, what happened? Every little Egyptian kid did the same thing. So the snake of Moshe swallowed their snakes. Why the Torah had to tell us this embarrassing moment? You come to brag that you can do magic. Every little filthy Egyptian idol worshiper does the same. Why this part appears in the Torah? Who knows? Why this part is in the Torah? Because today, there are many people who claim they have powers. They can do things. They see things. All kinds of things like that. And what happened? It's not a sign that he's a man of God. I was in Shabbaton with Valley Torah Yeshiva and a mountain in Los Angeles. There's mountain, Big Bear over there. Snow, freezing, like now here. Freezing. Snow, piles of snow. 2 hours away from LA. And Motzei Shabbos, they invited a mentalist. A goy. He read the mind of all the people. Said to the rabbi, think about something. I'll tell you what you're thinking about. The rabbi closed his eyes and said, okay, you thought about Abraham Lincoln. Everyone was shocked. He told everyone what he's thinking about. So what's the first question we have to ask? If he has this ability to read people's mind, no, what's the question? Why is not a billionaire? So he said, no one in a casino let him in. They already know him. I don't know, it doesn't sound so convincing to me. There's other casinos in the world, never heard of him. Maybe they send each other a warning, I don't know. And they already know about him. But I don't get it. Okay, casino, fine. But what about other things? It can help so much in business when you meet with people. You know what they think about you. You know if you get the job. You know what they think about you, so you know what to say. If you go to an interview and the boss is thinking, this guy is not dressed properly. Everything else about him is nice. And you know he's thinking that your clothes is not fancy enough. He doesn't know you read his mind. So you tell him, I have to apologize today that I came with this kind of suit because I was supposed to go from my house and change clothes to come to the interview. But I got stuck. So automatically, you fix the problem as you talk to him. Or if he's thinking he doesn't have enough experience, you don't know what to say, if you read his mind. Why do you need to go and make shows to kids? I don't know why, but it's a fact that he knew what people think. Incredible. The power of the mind. The power of the mind. Any questions before we finish?
Rabbi,
yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
How come Moses, there weren't any witnesses?
Which one?
Moshe Rabbeinu, right?
Yeah.
There weren't any witnesses when he was talking to God through the burning bush.
When he was talking to God in a bush?
Burning bush, yeah.
Bush, it's not the... We are not Jewish based on the discovery that Moshe had by the bush. Judaism didn't start by the bush. It started in Mount Sinai in front of millions of people. Millions of witnesses saw it. If it was only the bush, you're right. We have a very serious problem. Then we couldn't say to the Christian, what's the difference? We are just as bad. You had a dream, and a Muslim had Muhammad in the desert, and we had the bush. All three religions started with 50% doubt. But that's not what happened. You understand? The idea was that we, the Jewish people, are the only nation that received the Torah in a public event. Don't ever forget that. We didn't start with the bush. Remember, the bush is way before. Mount Sinai, that's where the Judaism started, when all Jews heard Moshe and Hashem speaking. Any questions before we finish? Any? Yeah.
How was Moshe talking to Hashem in the bush? Was he sleeping or was he just...
Moshe was the only prophet that spoke to Hashem when he was awake. All other prophets had to be asleep, and they had this revelation when they sleep, when they have to lay down or sit. That's why it says, Lo kam od navi ke Moshe, that Moshe was able to come, to get up on his feet. Panim befanim adaber imo. That's what Hashem said to Miriam and Aaron, how do you dare to speak against Moshe that he left Zipporah when you know that he's, you're also a prophet, both of you, but you know that you're not like him. He's the only one I speak to him face to face, which means you have to give him respect that he's the greatest prophet. By the way, it's one of the 13 principles of Judaism. One of the 13 principles of Judaism is that Moshe Rabbeinu is the master of all prophets, which means all the prophets are, they gave divine prophecy. Aval Moshe was special. Why? He was able to receive his prophecy while he was awake. No, any more? Yeah.
What did the other Jewish women do with their babies? You said that Miriam hid Moshe, but what did the other women do after they were killed?
Good point. They were killing the baby. They wanted to kill the. Later, they threw all the babies to the Nile. There was a period of time that they threw all the babies to the water. But they looked at the stars and they thought that the baby that's supposed to save the Jews already is in the water. Why do you think Miriam, why do you think they put Moshe in the water? To protect the baby, it's better to put him in the water or better to hide him in the bushes? Water is dangerous. Wind, that, it can flip over. It can go to places you don't know where it carry you. But if you hide them in the bushes, there's bushes. So you hide it, you know a place, you make yourself, you know, a little bit nice bushes around him, and you put him, and every day you come, you feed him, and you run back, you run, until he grows up. Why you have to put him in the water that he's going to go to the other side of the lake, especially the Nile? It carries everything with it. Because the Egyptian made this decree to throw all the Jewish babies to the water, thinking, they said to Pharaoh, their savior is about to be born. They were reading in the stars. Their savior is about to be born. So throw all of them to the water. And every day they check. All of a sudden they say, oh, that baby that's supposed to save them is already in the water. But they didn't see that it's in a box. So when they say to Pharaoh, you don't have to kill them anymore. He's already in the water. You're safe. And reality, not only he got saved, Hashem sent him to Pharaoh's house to raise him. Nobody. Rabot machashavot belevish. V'atzat Hashem itakum. People that come and claim Hashem spoke to me, tell them, Dr. Eisenberg, psychiatrist, 1-800. How do I know? Maybe Hashem spoke to him. What does the Gemara say? After the destruction of the second temple, there's no more prophecy. People like us, Hashem will talk to us? What a shame to even claim such thing. It's probably the LSD. That's, by the way, proof that the Quran, it's all nonsense. Because how Muhammad can be a prophet when they believe in the Torah, and the Torah says that after the destruction of the second temple, there's no more prophecies. The Torah says the prophecy was given to the Shotim and to the Ktanim. Shotim means retarded kids, retarded people, I'm sorry. And Ktanim means kids. Maybe Muhammad, since he wasn't able to read and write, they consider him as retarded. I don't know. Otherwise, there's no explanation. If the Arabs claim that Muhammad is retarded, then he can be a prophet. But if he was normal, like smart, functioning, and all that, then he cannot be a prophet, because the Torah says the prophecy is only to retarded and to children. People with brain damage, or little kids that they don't even know they say a prophecy. There's no more prophecy. Why? Because we don't have the level anymore for prophets. Same thing, the leader of the generations. You compare the leaders of today's generation to the leaders of 1,000 years ago? Do you know what would happen if the Rambam would walk here 1 minute around us, the Rambam, what would happen in the world? Or Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai? The world would be boiling, shaking, when they see who these people were. We don't have people like this in the world. Yiftach bedoro keshmuel bedoro. Yiftach in his generation, like Samuel in his generation. There's nothing to compare. The level of generation by Yiftach was very low. Yiftach is the king. By Shmuel, it was a high generation. David HaMelech, Nathan HaNavi, a lot of important people. Shmuel is the leader. I once made a lecture about it. What determined what? The level of the people determine the level of the leaders, or the level of the leaders determine the level of the people? Do you understand the question or no? Which means, since the leaders are not so great, they make the nation be like this. Or no, the other way around. Since the nation is in such a low level, what's the point of giving them a very, very holy, high level leader? Anyway, they won't listen to him. They do whatever they want anyway. Most of the people today that they claim they have a rabbi, they don't listen to him unless if what he say they like to hear. Soon as he tells them something they don't like to hear, they find a way around it. It's all scam, ma. My rabbi. Your rabbi told you also not to do this and this and that. Ah, yeah, I forgot. I made a lecture, two or three weeks ago, on my website. How do you choose a rabbi? If your rabbi is politically correct, everything sugar coating, everything sweetie, sweetheart, no problem, as long as the check is nice. Everything is beautiful. No. How is he going to direct you in the right path? The politics penetrates every place now. Every place. I wonder when Mashiach comes, what's going to be? How many people will demonstrate against Mashiach? Huh? If the Mashiach will be Hasidish, the Litvish will go crazy. What? Read the Brisker, Limud, Iyun, Pkius, Hasidish, how can it be? If it's going to be Litvish, the Hasidim will say, cannot be, ma. It cannot be. It will be Sfaradi, Yemenite. Imagine if the Mashiach is going to be Bukharian with this color yarmulke. On a donkey. Made in Uzbekistan. He comes like this to all the briskers, or to Lakewood Yeshiva. He comes like this. Maybe he has a gold tooth or one or two. You know, and he comes like that and he say, Bismo Ishmo. Who are you? I'm Mashiach ben David. You know what's going to happen in Yeshivot? Ponovich for that. Imagine the Mashiach will be a Mori from Yemen. He come with his pajama, you know, this long kilt with a special hat with the antenna. Mori. He comes like this. He says, excuse me? The politics is a poison. It kills us from inside. That's the price, by the way, of the exile. Why we have all these disagreements? It's the punishments of Hashem spreading us in the exile. If we would not make sins, Hashem would not spread us. If he would not spread us, we will have one nation, one customs, one language, one accent, one menu of food. Huh? You come to Bukhari and you say, I have a Kafkazi girl for you. He doesn't talk to you for the rest of your life. You come to the Kafkazi, you say, I have a Bukhari girl for you, you're done by him. Rabbi, the check that I send you, don't cash it. Why? Oh, you killed his ego. So as an ignorant person, he said, I don't understand. You're 10 miles away here in the border. Same area, same rice, same everything. No, you don't understand. There's a big difference. Tell the Persian, marry this Afghani girl. Both of them speak Farsi. Afghani? Forget about this. Come to the Persian, say to him, where are you from? Shiraz. Here, there's a girl from Kashan. Ooh, Kashan, not for me. We only Tehrani. Tehrani, find me only Tehrani. You come to the Mashadi, you say, I have a beautiful girl from Isfahan for you. No, no, am I? We only Mashadi. Bottom line, you come to this Hasid, what are you? Bobov. I have a Hasidat Vishnitz for you. No. Well, same accent, same Yiddish, same Kegel, same gefilte fish, same everything. Both of them have a fair hat, everything the same. Same, you know, nobody can tell the difference. No, we Bobover, and he's Vishnitz, and he's Satmer. That's what happened. I always wonder, I think about it a lot. I say when Mashiach comes, it has to be one, unless it will be a mixture of everything.
This is a woman.
Maybe it's Faraday who learned by the Ashkenazim, who actually has some Hasidish customs, and it's Jachnun. It has to be something mixed, that everyone will have empathy for him. Until it will happen, we will sit and wait, Bezrat Hashem. Next Monday, I'm not here. And the following Monday, also, I'm not here. I'm going away.
Huh? Next Sunday, Rabbi Shefer across the street.
Next Sunday, Rabbi Shefer across the street in Sha'arei Tova. And the following Monday, you know also? No. We'll find out. By me, it's very easy to know where I am. On the day of the lecture, divineinformation.com, event. You have it also on the app. Android app, Apple app, and Windows. We try to give the cover for all kinds of people, you know, to cover everything. So you go, you click on events, and you see. If it shows you that I'm in LA, then I'm not here. If it shows you next Monday I'm in Israel, obviously I cannot be in Israel and here at the same time. So you know not to come. Thank you very much. We'll see you.